Hey guys, welcome back to the shop. My name's Adam. So we're working on another episode of SNS here. I believe this one's gonna be 13. And got a few things in store for you. We've got some projects that we worked on this past week. And my buddy Gil came by, paid a visit, and he brought the vise back, and we worked on that a little bit, so I'm gonna show you that. We got a box in. Came in yesterday. I'm gonna bring that over. We're gonna check that out. And what else did I have for you? I had a project that I worked on this week, and I'm gonna share that project with you in this video. And also have something special to go with that job that'll be at the end of this video. So stick around for that. And I think that's about it. All the content I can think of right now that's going to be in it, but I did want to share a couple things with you, if you don't mind. Things have been pretty busy for me lately, and I haven't had a whole lot of time to be able to come out in my shop and do some work, and things have been just getting backed up here, man. The work's been constantly coming in, and luckily this week I haven't really gotten anything else in here, but My other job has been really demanding here lately, and I've been having to work a lot of hours, upwards to 10 to 12 hours a day, and had a lot of pressure on me. And the work that comes in here, I have to take care of also. And things have just been getting behind, and I haven't had a lot of time to play with the camera and make videos. I didn't have a project video this week to put up because I've just been real busy. And just getting behind. And I'm actually thinking about backing off some of the work right now, just because I really have little to no time for myself. I've been out here in the shop constantly working. Whenever I'm home, I'm out here working. Weekends, I'm having to put off family events. Can't go to that because I got jobs to get done. So some of my customers that have been bringing stuff here on the regular basis, I think that I'm going to just pause for a while and try to get what I have in the shop here caught up, get done, because I got a lot of things that I need to do. I've still got to finish cleaning out my old shop. I've got a few things down there. I showed you in a video what's down there. I got to get those things out, and I want to get that done. I also need to get, I want to get my air conditioner down here and start getting that hooked up. And it's starting to warm up. I'm sitting here sweating already because it's starting to get hot. But the other thing that I want to do is, you notice my ceiling. I've had a lot of people make comments about my ceiling and ask me how come I haven't finished it, what's wrong with it, when you're going to do it. Actually, that's the original ceiling in here. And where it's not up there, that has fallen over time. Luckily, I haven't had any fall whenever I've set this up as a shop. But whenever it was just my garage, I would come in here and there'd be another section done falling down. So what I'm planning on doing is finish removing the rest of this drywall that's up there, because it's starting to fall. And I'm going to put plywood up there. I have a friend that does construction work and carpentry work, and me and him's worked out a deal. He's going to come help me do this. So hopefully we're going to be able to work on that pretty soon. And that's probably going to take, I don't know, maybe a couple weekends or so to get it done, maybe even more than that. So whenever I'm working on this, I don't need to be pressured with jobs get done, because we're going to be working on it. Lights are going to be down. So hopefully I'm going to take a break here pretty soon and get some of my things done. But I've got other stuff that I need to get finished up here. I've got that job for James Green. James, I still got your job, and I'm planning on getting on it real soon. Hopefully get it done and get it sent back to you. And I guess that's about it. That's what I wanted to share with you about what's been going on here. Also, one more thing. I got to thank all of my subscribers. There's a bunch of you out there now. I'm getting very close to 10,000 subscribers, and I'm just... as I've said before, I was blown away at this, man. I've never expected for my YouTube channel to ever take off like it has. And I just can't thank everybody enough for the support that I've gotten. all of the comments that I get, all of the suggestions, all the well wishes. You know, you guys have been following me for, you know, almost a year now, and it's just been a great, it's been a really fun adventure coming out here and doing this stuff. My total views peaked 1 million views this past Saturday. I was pretty excited to see that. I didn't expect that either. So, as I said, we're getting real close to 10,000 subscribers, and maybe next week I'll hit 10,000. So, I just wanted to share that with you guys, a little bit of excitement there. So, thanks again for all that you do. All of the viewers that have been sending in gifts for me, and I can't thank you enough. So, thanks very much to everybody for all of your views, comments, and everything. So, all right. So, enough with the chit chat. I'm going to go ahead and we're going to move on. We've got some things to show you. Okay. Gil down there working on the bike. Hey, what are you doing, dude?
Hey, man, working on a bike.
All right.
Looking good.
Doing a good job. He's getting his bike cleaned up and getting ready to paint it. Alright, so here's our viewer appreciation mail of the week. We've got a nice big box. This comes to us from Tom Lipton, Ox Tool. So he sent me a couple nice items here. We're going to go ahead and pull them out and take a look at them. So the first thing, this nice big stirrup box. And if you follow his channel, you'll see that he had actually talked about this. He's something that he picked up at the flea market, and I told him that I was interested in it, so me and him worked out a trade. So this is a 4-inch travel stirrup dial indicator right here, and I was joking with Tom because whenever he had showed this in his video, Tom, this is a plastic tube that Starrett supplies with these to protect, you know, the rod here, and I believe he had put it on like that. It was saying, hey, I don't know, that's a little too short. Well, Tom, inside there's a couple little plastic divots, I guess, little tits in there, and it actually fits on this way. It just goes on, and it's supposed to stop just like that. And it protects the indicator here on this end. And the only reason I know that is because whenever I bought a 2-inch travel, they supplied the same tube with that, and it was the same way. So anyway, man, I was just joking with you there, buddy. But so that's it. This is a really nice indicator. It's still in really good shape. It doesn't look like it's had a lot of use. I can see a little bit of like somebody's almost hit the end here with some Scotch-Brite or something to polish the end up, clean it up. So it might have been in a little bit of a dirty environment, but it works great. So since I do not have DRO on my lathe, this would be something nice to have once in a while. So what I'm going to do is go ahead and get me another mag back for this indicator. And I don't know if I'm going to get the stirrup or buy one of the imports. I haven't decided yet. I've noticed that the imports actually have a stronger hold than the stirrup does. But the stirrup is a nicer quality unit. So I don't know yet. I might just get one of the cheap ones and try it out on this and see how it does, as long as it fits good and doesn't move around. Because the last one I had bought had a plastic back on it, and it was kind of flimsy, so I don't know. We'll play with it, but So anyway, this is the 4-inch travel dial indicator from Tom. Put the lid back in here. This is a really nice item. And he told you in his video that he paid $33 for this thing. And if you was to buy a brand new one today from Sterrett, you're gonna pay probably around $550 to $600, somewhere in that range for one of these brand new. So that's a really high ticket item right there. So he's got a couple more things in here for me. And here's the second item. And you see it's some safety glasses. And he wrote me a little note. He's got some more safety glasses right here. He says, caution, wear eye protection when operating this indicator. Anti-doink. Because he said, you gotta be careful. This thing will poke your eye out, man. So Tom, thank you for the safety glasses. Look at those, man, you can't beat them. Those look like some show enough riding glasses right there. What do you think? Might have to sport these whenever I'm using the indicator. All right, so we got our eye protection that'll go with our new indicator. Doink. All right, what else we got? And we got one more item right here that I talked him out of. Here. Yep. Okay. This should be the Sterrett 289. Yep. This is a Sterrett 289 clamp. This is another item that he had got at the flea market. And I told him I've been looking for one of these things. And I was actually getting ready to buy one. And he found this and showed it in his video. And I asked him, hey, since you said you got two of them, will you trade me? So he said, sure, and sent me this. And this is the Sterrett number 289A. And what this will do is you can take two of your rules that I call scales. And, these aren't the right ones. If you use the type of rule that goes with your combination squares, of course I don't have any handy. But anyway, this will hold two of your scales at 90 degrees. Okay. There's been a lot of jobs where I needed something like this because I am holding two scales at 90 degrees trying to scribe some lines. So I've been wanting to get one of these. I finally got one, so I got to thank Tom for sending this to me. There's another attachment that you can use with this, and it's called the 289C. And it's another attachment that it's a block that clamps on here, and then it comes with a rule, a rod, and a scriber. And you can use it for checking depths or for numerous things. And I don't have that with me here, but what I wanted to do was get a hold of this, and I want to bring some of these things out and demonstrate some of these different attachments that goes on these scales. I've got another one in the toolbox that I wanted to show you guys also. All right, so there's another shot of it again, the Sterrett 289A, and it's in fine condition. So what I had offered Tom as part of the trade for this deal is I just acquired another Sterrett level, and I got it right here. I just got this. This is a 12-inch Sterrett, and it's in really good shape. Now, it does have some very, very light surface rust on here, and that's because it's been sitting for over 20 years in the guy's toolbox. He hasn't touched it, it's just been sitting there. But he told me, he said he had no need for it. I got this from a coworker, and he acquired this in a trade, He said about 22 years ago he got this, and he doesn't have any need for it. He needs a little bit of machine work done. So he said, hey, if you want that level, I'll give it to you if you'll do that little bit of machine work for me. So I told him, hell yeah. So I asked Tom, would he be interested in a new stair at level? And he does, he wants it. So I'm gonna send this to him. And I've got a couple other things that I'm gonna send you, Tom. I've got a couple little things that I'm gonna pick out for you. So here's all the drills that Tom Bellis sent me. I showed you in another video. Tom, I'm gonna grab a handful of these and send them to you. Because, you know, Tom said to share these with other guys, and that's what I'm gonna do. And I don't need all of these, so I'm gonna send you a good chunk of these, and then you can take them and throw them away or use them or give them away, whatever you wanna do. And I got some other things that I'm gonna throw in the box for you too. So anyway, so we're gonna go ahead and move on. This is the stuff from today. So thanks a lot, Tom. I really appreciate it, man. I love the indicator, love the clamp, and the anti-doink glasses. Hey, what's up, guys? All right, getting ready to start on this next project I got here. This is the other job that I got to do for my friend Chris Rayburn. I just built the axle for his bike, and so this is the next thing that I got to do for him here. So what we have is, this is the speedometer housing for his bike, and this also holds the handlebars. This is what bolts on to your trees and your bar goes through, and the speedometer, it's all right here. I've done taking it all apart. So got just the housing, and this goes to a Sportster 1200. So he's got a set of handlebars here, some of these Vortex bars. I believe these are dirt bike handlebars, and he's wanting to use these on his bike. So what he asked me if I could do was bore this housing here so that it will fit this this handlebar. So that's what we're gonna do. The factory size is 1 inch, so you got about a 1 inch hole here now. And the bar that he wants to use, this is 1 1/8. So we gotta set it up in line board. So I've been trying to figure out the best way to do this for me. And I've been playing around with it, coming up with some ideas. So I'll show you what I came up with, how I'm gonna do this. Here's one of my angle plates here. And I've got pairs of these, and these are just inexpensive pair angle plates. And I'm gonna end up drilling a couple holes here on the side of this angle plate so that what I can do is set this right here on the side and get it up kind of high so that there's no interference of the angle plate for the boring head, and you got a little clearance down there below for your bar to come through. So I'm gonna set this up, drill me a couple holes and bolt it to it, and then I'll line up this and go through there with the boring head and bore it out. And then the last thing I'll have to do is take the clamps off, and I'll have to set them up and do a little fly cutting or milling on the split line there, and I'll do it on these so that there's a little clearance so when it's pulled up, it pulls up tight around the bar. So, all right, so that's what we're doing. I'm just playing around with it right now, and I was trying to get a game plan on how I want to do this, so I wanted to share with you what the setup's gonna be like, and I feel like it's gonna work out pretty good. I may end up having to take a little piece of steel plate or something and drill a hole in it where I can clamp it in the vise and just stick these on there and put a bolt up to the bottom and hold them. But I do want to check them to see if the top here, you know, is completely parallel with the bottom. These are all casted, so I got to do some inspection work and see how it's going to work out for that. All right, well, I'm going to go ahead and start setting some stuff up. All right, I'm just getting my angle plate set up. Wanted to show you this. I was checking the squareness of the angle plate, But the way I usually set things like this up, especially when it's not really critical, is just use a combination square and, you know, pull it up, square against the table and over against the face of the part that you're trying to square up, in this case being the angle plate. All right, you can get it really, really close with that. Now, I haven't bumped this. I tightened it down, and I wanted to just see how close that I was. So I'm using a stair back plunge indicator here. Already got it set to zero. And we're gonna run across it. All right, so it looks like maybe not quite 2/1000ths that amount, which is what I'm doing here. That's gonna be close enough. So I'm gonna leave it there, but that's just a little setup trick there. Just grab your square and square up your part, clamp it down, and it puts you really close. So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna use this side of the angle plate and I'll just drill me two holes. I'm gonna go 1/2 inch from the side. And I haven't calculated how far down I'm gonna start yet. So anyway, we're just gonna pop us two holes right here. All right, I found the edge and stepped it over. There's my starting point here. Center to center distance is 3.5 inches. So I'll drill this one and step it down 3.5. I'm gonna use a 1/4 inch drill to drill a pilot and then step it up to 1/2 inch. Gills inside using the blast cabinet, and I've never talked about my air compressor, which is right there running right now. If you ever think about running a blast cabinet, you got to make sure you got an air compressor that puts out enough CFM and volume of air to run it. So this Ingersoll Rand air compressor was bought at the same time we bought that blast cabinet, and that's why, because it runs a lot, it uses a lot of air. Kick on and off a little bit, but it uses a lot of air, so when you're using a blast cabinet, this thing's running quite a bit. So it's an Ingersoll Rand T30, got a 15 horse motor on it, and I think it puts out like 50 CFM. Gill inside, he's using a blast cabinet now. There's the press too. I'm gonna talk about that also, so just stay tuned for that. I've had some guys ask me about it, so there's a shot of it anyway. Okay guys, getting ready to set this thing up. All right, here's my two drill holes, and getting ready to bolt it up here. I found some cap head bolts, some 1/2-13ths, and that's what we're gonna use. I'm also gonna show you another little way that I'm gonna align this with the spindle. I went ahead and just turned me a little lineup pin in the Victor real quick, and I turned the end to 3/4 to fit a collet, and this is what I'm gonna use to line up this thing. See, it fits in there pretty nice. And I'm just gonna line this up with the pin and let it go from there. I think that's gonna give us, that's gonna bring us plenty close enough for what we want here. And there's very little rock back and forth this way. So I believe I'm just going to tighten them up there. I drilled a half inch hole, so those bolts are really, really close fit through there. Okay, I think that's going to be tight enough, and I do need to double check these bolts. I don't remember if I tightened them all the way. All right, that'll be good there. Oh, another thing, I left this angle plate set up here like this because I'm planning on setting this angle plate back up the way I had it before when I drilled the holes. And the way that these are mounted in here now is how I'll bolt them in to mill the tops of them off. That's running nice and true. I think I might have snugged that thing up whenever I tighten these other bolts up. It's going in there, but it's a lot more snug than it was before. Okay, I think I got it positioned where I want it there now. I can run this pin all the way down through there, and it's got a little bit of resistance, but I'm looking at the rubbing, which is on both sides here, and it looks pretty well equal. So I believe I'm gonna leave it right there where it's at. I'm gonna lock the table. And I'm going to go ahead and re-snug the bolts here a little bit. And I say we're lined up ready to bore. It's so bright and sunny outside, I had to bust out my shades. Got Gil over here. He got the vise parts blasted, and now he's throwing some primer on them. What do you think?
Oh, got the YouTube crowd.
Yeah, we got the YouTubers out here. They want to see what's going on.
It's my old new vise.
That's right. As Tom would say it. He's doing what I always wanted to do with this stuff, man. I don't ever seem to find time, but he's doing it right. We got her blasted, and he's getting ready to paint it up. And it's looking good.
I don't know about the painting skills, but...
Oh, it'll work. It'll work. You can actually read that now. Rock Island 574.
Nice vise, man.
Well, I'm glad it's going to a good home, man.
Get some good use.
He was in the market for a new vise for his welding table, and I showed him my secret stash. He had to have it, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
All right, well, as we said, we were going to give you some little segments of it, so.
I'll send pictures when I get the final coat mounted on the bench.
There you go.
So, see it in action.
Okay. So we'll get some pictures of it all painted up and looking nice and mounted on his workbench.
My welding bench.
Your welding bench.
Yeah, I call it the welding side of the garage.
On the other side of the car.
That's right.
Okay. All right, well, we're going to sign off. So maybe next time you'll see it finished up. I found me a boring bar. This is a 3/4 bar, and it's the perfect length to get all the way through here. And dug me up a little high speed tool bit. I just went over and touched it up and honed me a little radius on the corner. I'm gonna use this tool bit. It fits in the hole there. So what I'm gonna do is I need a wrench. That's the right one. I'm gonna come over and touch the side of that with that tool bit and just snug up that set screw. All right. All right, I'm touching on that side. And just touching that corner right there. So we're good to go. I'm gonna go ahead and I've already got it on zero. So what I'll do is just go ahead and let's see where we're at. We've got to take about 1/8 of an inch, but I want to take a light cut through there just to see how it's going. I think I'll just move it 10. But that'll be 20 thousandths off the diameter. Just enough travel to go down through both of them. We're going to try it fast first to see how it cuts. If I'm getting a bunch of chatter, then I might have to slow it down. Gotta get my feed set up here. To disengage the feed, I'll bring it on down. Just bring it close and engage it, start it again. I was just through at the bottom. We'll have to monitor that. Okay, I'm touching on both sides. I am getting some chatter because of this long bar. I might go ahead and try it again and see what kind of cut it'll do. It is a little bit fast, but all right, I'm just going to play with it and see. Now, I got to figure out how I'm going to get a measurement. I guess what I can do is just run it on down a little bit. And I know I got plenty more cuts that I got to take. So I'll just do it this way for now. Yeah, see, we're still well under 1 inch there. I'm gonna go ahead and take one revolution on the boring head, and that should be 50, and we'll give that a shot and see how it likes it. If it gets too rough, then I'll probably just slow it down. All the way at the top there. There we go. Looks like we're going to be cutting the full length of it now. Okay. So I'm just roughing it out, getting it close. So what I'm gonna do is, you know, that chatter, I don't like it. It doesn't look good. But what I wanna do is, I'm just roughing it out. So it just did make it through the bottom too for it backed off. So what I'm going to do is rough it out, get a little closer, and then I'm going to slow it down and run it at a slower RPM and hopefully eliminate some of that chatter. I went ahead and slowed down the RPM. It was just way too fast. It was trying to chatter. It was getting worse and worse. So I slowed it down to 210 on the motor here. Another pass through there, getting real close to my size. Went ahead and slowed it down again because the chatter just getting too bad. So just slowing it down, taking it nice and easy. Okay, I'm on the last cut now. I just dialed in my offset that I want, and it's going to bring it to 2 or 3 thousandths over inch and an eighth. But ran into a problem on this last cut. I noticed that I'm cutting into where the bolt comes across there. Now, it's just starting to touch it. And if I would have thought about this ahead of time, I would have offset the hole this direction just a little bit. But I didn't think about that. So now we got to deal with it. So what I've done is I moved the table that direction so that this finished cut is not cutting anymore on this side of the hole here. So most of your cut will be on this side right here. It'll just barely touch this side so that we're not taking any more out of this right here, because you know your bar's got to go in there and the bolt's got to go through. So once I get it bored, then we'll have to fit it and see how it works out. I think it's just enough to where it will work. I might even have to chuck these bolts up, these two on this side, and you know, machine the threads off right here in the middle to give it clearance so that when it does bolt up. So we're gonna find out here in a little while how it worked. So what I had to do, been getting a pretty good cut now. So what I did, I slowed it down. I'm running 135 RPM, and I kicked the feed up to the 5,000ths feed rate on the quill, and that helped out a lot. And I'm having to get every bit of this travel out of this quill to get all the way through there. When it gets to the very bottom, I got maybe about an eighth of an inch or so that I'm having to hand crank the knee slowly up to bring it all the way through there. You can see the offset of the cut. Most of the cut's on this side, and that side there is just barely touching it. Okay, that's my finished pass, and I just checked the top right here with my telescope gauge, and I'm reading 1/1000ths over inch and an eighth, 1.126. I was actually trying to get a couple more thousandths out of it, but it didn't take what I wanted. So I'm going to use this longer telescope gauge and see if I can get down here and check this bottom, but I don't know if I'm going to get a good reading like this, but we'll try it. I wanted to see how close it was. So yeah, it's the same. 1 inch, 126. So I believe I'm going to leave it like that. I did want a couple more thou, but if I need to, I'll just hit it real lightly with a flapper, try to get another thousandth or two out of it. And I need to get it apart and see if those bars are going to clamp in there with the bolts. We might have to do a little bit of cutting on a couple of them bolts there. Alright, so I got her set back up like I had when I drilled the holes. And what I'm going to do is go ahead and bust this loose and test the fit of the handlebar itself and see if it works with the bolts looking like they might interfere a little bit. So I'm getting ready to do that. I wanted to give a quick thanks to my buddy Gil. He was at Lowe's today. He came and paid me a visit. And whenever he was there, he asked me if there was anything I needed. I said, well, there's always things I need, but that don't mean I have the money to pay for it. I said, I really need some new batteries for the DeWalt because my batteries were going bad. So he went and looked, and they had the, you could buy one 18-volt XRP battery for $99, or you could buy a two-pack of 18-volt XRP batteries for $99. So they had a two-pack there for $99 on sale, so I told him, I said, hell, man, pick them up for me. So Gil picked me up the pack of batteries for my DeWalt. Now it's working, and every time I come over here to the mill to use it, my battery's dead. Got to charge it, can't use it. So now I got some fresh batteries for my drill motor. So thank you, Gil, for picking me up the batteries. And I appreciate that, buddy. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and bust this thing loose. And we're going to go ahead and test fit these handlebars real quick. All right, here we go. We got the two halves. And I'm just going to move the drill over here. All right. That's a close fit. I think I need to flap them a little bit. Let's see if the bolts line up. Okay, so I've got all four of the bolts started, and actually whenever I was boarding this thing, even though I offset it to which was this side of it, the bore came through into where these two bolts come down through there. So I'm actually getting interference with all four bolts onto the handlebar, and it's not much, but the threads of the bolts are just touching the handlebar here. So you can screw all these down. They're a little bit snug, but you're getting a little bit of resistance from it. And I don't want to play with this too much because I keep putting scratches on it. All right, so I actually just got off the phone with Chris. I called him and told him the problems that we were running into here. And he was actually already kind of expecting this because he's seen it before. And he told me, he says, do not worry about it, to go on with it because this is his stump bite. And he said, don't sweat it. So I'm taking the handlebar back off. And you can see we've got us a, it's a close fit on here. We're getting a little bit of rub in here. It's rubbing the paint off of it. So whenever I'm done with this job, I'm probably gonna go ahead and bolt this back on there. I'm gonna run my flapper through here just to kind of open it up just a little bit more, because it is a very close fit. You can see that I can set that on there. And it's tight, which is good. That's a good fit, but you know, this is a machinist fit, right? You probably want a little bit more clearance than that, but I was shooting for that and just didn't get it the way I wanted it. So, all right, so I'm gonna go ahead and move this stuff off out of the way. All right. And next thing I wanna do, I'm gonna set up a mill. And I'm going to go ahead and mill the top of these trees, or not, these aren't the trees, these are the risers, I guess you'd call them. And I'm going to take a little bit of metal off these so that there is some clamping area there to pull down tight on the bar. So I'm going to get set up, I'm going to find me a cutter, and we'll mill a little bit off of those. Alright, just getting ready to do a little bit of milling here, just using a 3/4 4 flute end mill. And coming up and getting ready to touch off. I've already measured them to see how flat that plane was, and I'm getting a few thousandths difference between that side and this side, which really isn't a big deal what we're doing here. I'll show you what I'm talking about. All right, so I'm touching that side there, right? Come over here to this side. Alright, it's not touching. I'll set my zero. We'll come up and see. Okay, I just moved it 4/1000ths. And it's just cutting the paint off. So that's pretty good for a casting. So what I'm gonna do to give it a little bit of gap there, we want to take a 32nd off. Move it up 31. And that's what clearance is going to be there. Okay, well that's it. All right, I just got to do a little bit of deburring, and I'll get rid of these sharp edges on it, bolt it back together, and I'm gonna do a little bit of flapping in here, and that job be done. Hey guys, all right, so I finally got Chris's clamps here done. All right, we got them line bored. And I called them and talked about the problem that we're having here with the bolts. Maybe you can see that in the video. The bolts that's coming through this way is just barely interfering with the diameter here, inch and eight diameter. But I called him and he said, don't worry about that. He's going to run them anyway. He just uses this bike for stunting. So I went ahead and I deburred everything. I ran my flapper through there on both sides to kind of dress it up, and really all I got left to do is to put it back together, because he brought it to me. See, there's your speedo, And all that does is that fits in there like that. And then you got to hook your wire up on the back side here. And here's the plug that's gonna plug into here. And you got another rubber boot that seals it. And then the cover plate that goes down, and there's the two screws that pulls everything down, and you got the wire hanging out here. So I'm gonna do that off camera and get it back together for them. But I think the job ended up turning out okay. And like I said, I talked to him and told him what we were running into, and he said that was fine, so we went with it. So this one's done for him, and he's getting ready to do a show here in a couple weeks, he said. And I'm hoping to maybe find a couple pictures that I can show some of his cool stunts that he does on them bikes, and I'm going to throw up in the video here for you. So anyway, so this job's done. Chris is ready to go, and appreciate you guys watching, okay? I hope it was fun for you. It was fun for me. I was glad to share it with you, and thank you for checking it out. All right, guys. Go pick out another job to start on, okay? Just thought I'd give you guys a final look at this setup right here. There's the clamps and the handlebars, and they fit in there. They're nice and snug. I just put it all back together. I put the tack back in there. Just wanted you guys to see what it looks like. So, you know, these bolted up to the trees. Feel nice. It's my style, Chris. I like it, man. I like the dirt bike bars. So he can loosen these up, and he can rotate these bars where he needs to, but it's actually a nice tight fit. So I think it'll work out pretty good for him. Just wanted you guys to see that.